Good morning, brothers and sisters. This is Pastor Lee. You will not find any videos of myself during these lectures. Why? Because it is not about me, but the focus should be on the gospel. We hope that you had a good week, and I hope you are wearing your mask and social distancing during this crisis. Once again, we thank you for tuning in to the Pastor.Faith YouTube channel. We are bringing you messages using the manuscripts, which were the original writings and interpretation into the King James Bible. This will give each and every one of us a clear view and understanding of the Bible, which was created with the wisdom of God, to teach with clarity and understanding, not to confuse. As we look at the book of James, chapter 1, verse 5 through 6, it teaches us, if any lack wisdom, let him ask of the Lord, who giveth to all men and women freely. So go with us now into another lecture, where some are recorded live and some come directly from the desk of the pastor. Come follow us with your Bibles as we follow Christ.
Amen. We're going to talk today about Abram's. If we remember, Abram's name was changed from Abram's to Abraham. And God changed that further down the road after he started and committed himself to God to serve him. And also he changed Sarah's name. Her name was Sarai. He changed that to Sarah. So the title of this lesson today is Abram's Commitment to God. Abram's Commitment to God. Now, as we look at, I'm going to give you several scriptures so you can do some research yourself. And also this will be on the website likewise. When we look back in Acts 7:3, New Testament records, and I told him, and this is he told Abraham, leave your country and your kindred and go to the land I will show you. Now, out of everybody, he chose Abram because of Abraham's faith. And I believe Abram was looking for something to have faith in. Because if you remember where he was from, the country, and that particular country, they were idol worshipers. They worship anything but God. And Abraham had just something, a genuine heart, just like you and I do. And that's why we're here. Because we've been looking all our lives for something to worship that was genuine. And Abram was that one at that time. As we look at Hebrews chapter 11, verse 8, it says, by faith, Abraham, when called to go to a place he would later receive as his inheritance, he obeyed and went without knowing where he was going. And isn't that kind of what this journey here is when we hear about the Lord and about who he is and what he has to offer us? And when we leave this earth, if we follow suit, that we're going to be with him. Isn't that under the same pretense? We're not sure where we're going. We just heard a lot of things, but we have to choose this way by faith. By faith. Everyone say by faith. The Lord also told him, I am the Lord who brought you. This is Genesis 15:7. The Lord also told him, I am the Lord who brought you out of Ur. That was a reminder of the Chaldeans to give you this land to possess. And you know something? It's something when you stop and think. through this whole earth, God was looking for someone that he could give something genuine to. Out of everything that was already created, he found one man that his heart was genuine and would appreciate knowing who he is and what he brings to the table. Abram learned quickly to bring God into every equation, whether through prayer or to give thanks for a victory. And this is something we as a church have to practice every day. Practice our prayer time with God, praying for individuals, praying for ourselves, and also taking time out to praise him and give thanks when things are going good. Sometimes we forget to acknowledge him when things are going good and give him the praise and the victory. Now, when we look at Genesis 13:4, unto the place of the altar which he had made there at first, and there Abram called on the name of the Lord. Now, here's the wonderful part about this is, God did not tell Abram to build an altar. He didn't tell him to build an altar. He just told him, come out and follow me. I've got some great things for you. And Abram recognized who God was and that he was faithful and that he needed to show him his appreciation. So he got together the wood and other obstacles that he needed to build an altar. And if we follow Abram, he took this altar and wherever he went, reassembled it, and got down and prayed to God and praised God when events came his way that turned out either good or when he needed help, he prayed and asked God for help. When we look at Genesis chapter 14, verse 13, and there came one that had escaped. And this, let me back up a little bit. Here we had a little confrontation that was going on in that land where there were many kings that decided that they would create a dilemma and go and start to take every little town and every little country over and steal their crops, steal their belongings, take their wives, and kill the men. And so they went on a rampage. First, they were worshiping amongst each other, and then they got rebellious against each other, and then they decided to go on a rampage. So now, back to chapter 14, verse 13. And there came one that had escaped and told Abram, the Hebrew, for he dwelleth in the plain of Mamre, the Amorite, brother of Eshcol, and brother of Anar. And there were a confederate with Abraham. Now, what this is an allegiance. They had allegiance with Abraham. When issues and things were going on, they shared it with Abram so he would know what was going on. And as we go to verse 14, and when Abram heard that his brother was taken captive, he armed his trained servants, born in his own house, 318, and pursued them unto Dan. Now, this is just really, really exciting to know that Abram didn't trust an alliance with anybody as far as sharing their army or going with them or with him up against a situation. But he raised his own army in his own household and taught them the things that they needed to know and how to fight for righteousness. And when it was time to fight, they were all in one mind and one accord. There wasn't no exaggeration about, oh, no, you said this, you said that. No, I understand this or I understand that. No, everyone is on one mind and one accord. And he divided himself against them. That was those that were doing all of the problem causing and the trouble causing, going around defeating all these towns. He divided himself against them, he and his servants. So they split themselves up so that they could surround them and take care of them. And his servants by night, and smote them and pursued them unto Hobah, which is on the left hand of Damascus. Verse 16, and he brought back all the goods, and also brought again his brother Lot and his goods, and the woman and the women also, and the people. Gathered them all back, brought them back, those that were taken and kidnapped, got them all back. And the king of Sodom went out to meet him. Now they went through Sodom too and took everything from them likewise. But the king of Sodom went out to meet him after his return from the slaughter of Chesalon and of the kings that were with him at the valley of Shaveh, which is the king's dale. Now, you may wonder in your mind, the answer to Abraham's victory, who was it? It was Melchizedek. Who was Melchizedek? He didn't have an earthly mother, didn't have an earthly father. He brings forth wine and bread, which represents his body and blood that was sacrificed on the cross, which was to come. And so we know that this was Jesus appearing at the beginning. And Melchizedek, king of Salem, brought forth bread and wine, and he was the priest of the Most High God. Here we have the appearance of Jesus Christ in the beginning. In the beginning. Now, as we go back through Hebrews in the New Testament, and they testify to this, Paul's writing in the book of Hebrews, for this Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest of the Most High God, to whom also Abram gave a tenth part of all, first being by interpretation king of righteousness, and after that also king of Salem, which is king of peace. Verse 3, without father, without mother, without descent, having neither beginning of days nor end of life, but made like unto the Son of God, abideth a priest continuously. So his priestly title didn't start when he came through the birth of Mary, but it started at the beginning. Verse 4, now consider how great this man was, unto whom even the patriarch Abraham gave the tenth of the spoils to. He met Abram returning from the slaughter of the kings and blessed him. Now, there was a controversy about this whole thing when we read in John chapter 8, verse 53. And this is Jesus in the New Testament confirming it. And these were the folks that he was dealing with at the time, the Pharisees and the Sadducees. And they asked, art thou greater than our father Abraham, which is dead, and the prophets that are dead? Whom makest thou thyself? Whom makest thou thyself? When all these are dead. And Jesus answered, if I honor myself, my honor is nothing. It is my Father that honoreth me, of whom ye say that he is your God. Yet ye have not known him, but I know him. And if I should say, I know him not, I shall be a liar like unto you. But I know him and keep his sayings. Your father Abraham rejoices to see my day, and he saw it and was glad. John 8:57. Then said the Jews unto him, thou art not yet 50 years old, and hast thou seen Abraham? And what were they doing? They were looking into the physical. They weren't looking into the spiritual. So you can have people that are sitting alongside of you that are trying to argue with you about God and what they believe versus what you believe. But you got to find out one thing first. Where is their mindset? Their mindset is in the physical, not the spiritual. And Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am. Whoa, was that a slap in the face? Before Abraham was, I am. And of course, they were not going to sit down and try to reckon with him or anything. And verse 59 says, and then took they up stones to cast out him, but Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple, going through the midst of them, and so passed by them. So he hid himself. But he is confirming that he just didn't arrive. He always was. And he knows more about these things than they do, because they were looking to have power over anybody that they could. Now let's go back to Genesis 14, 19. And he blessed him, this is Melchizedek, and said, blessed be Abraham of the Most High God, God the possessor of heaven and earth. Excuse me. And verse 20. And blessed be the Most High God, which hath delivered thine enemies unto thy hand. And he gave him tithes of all. Now, anybody knows that God was the deliverer of this event. When you go with 315 people, or 315 of an army against these kings of many, many people, and God gives you the victory. And the king of Sodom, now you know who that is. You have Sodom and Gomorrah. The king of Sodom said unto Abram, give me the persons and take the goods to thyself. So he was trying to make a deal with him. But Abram knew who he was. He knew what he stood for. And he was not about to be manipulated by an enemy. And the reason why, let's get it correct here. The only reason that he went into battle was because they made the mistake and came and took Lot. Now, if Lot wasn't involved in it, he wouldn't have never lifted a hand. But they came and took his own. Verse 22, and Abram said to the king of Sodom, I have lifted my hand unto the Lord, the Most High God, the possessor of heaven and earth, that I will not take from a thread even a shoelace, and that I will not take anything that is thine, lest thou should say, oh, I help make Abraham rich. I'm not giving you that opportunity. And he goes on to say, verse 24, save, which means accept, only that which the young men have eaten, and the portion of the men which went with me, Anar, Eshcol, and Mamre. Let them take their portions. But that was it. And that was their portions of food that they needed and to get themselves back on track. But you're not giving me nothing, because I stand before the Lord and the Lord stands with me. Now, every time God gave Abram instructions, he obeyed him. And when he didn't, he knew where the altar was. Everyone say he knew where the altar was. I asked you, do you know where your altar is? Your altar is within. Stop whatever you're doing, wherever you're at, and pray. And praise God. It's not like you have to go build an altar and get everything erected. And now, okay, now I got to take time out. Now, oh God, I got to call upon your name. Because of Jesus Christ, the Spirit that lives within you, the altar of God lives within you. You can approach him at any place, at any time, and talk to him. You don't need a priest to go pray for you. You don't need a priest to make intercessory for you. Jesus Christ is the high priest. He made the accessory for you and makes it every day. All you have to do is say, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ. And I can see Jesus standing and saying, Father, that's my brother down there. That's my sister down there. I told them whatever they asked you in my name. You will stand at attention and address it. And that's how he does us. Remember, God did not instruct Abram to build an altar. He did it on his own to worship him and show his love toward him. Abram could not afford to leave God out of the equation because he knew from God that all blessings flow from him. The Prince of Peace, King of Kings. And I say to all of us today, remember, whatever you're going through, whatever your challenges is, take it to God. Use that altar that's within and begin to speak to him and lay it down and say, this is my needs and I am trusting you. Just like you hear me say quite often, Lord, I'm praying for these doctors that you will lead them, guide them, let them see whatever they can't see, that I will be taken care of, healed, and that I will be set free. Because you have the last say. They're only sharing your technology, your wisdom. And I'm not putting faith in them, but I'm putting it in you, Lord. And when we do that, we can rest assured that we're being taken care of. St. John 8:56, before Abraham was, Jesus said, I am. Always thank him for the blessings that he brings in your life. And understand, Satan's job is to stir up discontentment within yourself. So you don't pray as much anymore. You don't talk to God much anymore. You try to seek other philosophies. You try to talk to your friends and listen to what their advice is. The bottom line is, the Lord, if he's in your corner fighting for you, you don't need a backup. You've got him. And many of us that are here today have been in the hospital, have been laid up, and they didn't know what they were doing. But what do? We continue to pray and exercise that altar, that voice, and give it to God. And guess what? You're here today. I'm here today. And it's because we put him above everything and included him in every equation of our life. Amen. Father, today we honor you and thank you and praise you for your teachings. And we know there's no other lesson taught above your lessons. And we pray that we would be able to take it, chew it, digest it, and bring forth spiritual prosperity, physical prosperity to your will and your glory. Be with us. And keep us and strengthen us and keep us in that frame of mind. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you once again for joining us at the Pastor.Faith YouTube channel. And we encourage you to continue to have a conversation with God on a daily basis. Not many people have the time or take the time to talk to him, but he wants to be your best friend. Also continue to consider receiving him as Lord and Savior in your life and allowing him to work a great peaceful work in your life, knowing that all things work together for the good to them that love God. Also remember to continue to repent, confessing, asking forgiveness of all of our sins on a daily basis. And the most important thing is, after receiving Christ as Lord and Savior, is receiving his forgiveness in your heart. God bless you until next time. And the God of the good.
still God in my bad time, the God of the day. He's still God in the night. Oh, you talk of faith when you're up on that mountain. Oh, but talk comes so easy when life's at its best. Oh, but it's down in the valley of trials and temptations, 'cause that's where faith is really put to the test. Oh, the God of the mountain, still God in the valley when things go wrong. You make them right. The God of the good time is still God in the bad time. The God of is still God in the night.
Yes, he is.
The God of the day. Oh, yeah, the good time. The God of the day.
God of the, go back to that key just for a second.
The God of the mountain,
sing it with me.
It's to God in the valley when things go wrong. He'll make them right. The God of the still God in the bad time, the God of the day is still God in the night. Oh, the God of the day, the God of the day.
Believe that. Go ahead and give it. I'll give it. That's all.